In the previous video tutorial, we had discussed about allosteric regulation. Now, in this video tutorial, I will discuss about covalent modification, proteolytic activation, and cascade mechanism as a part of regulation of enzyme activity in a living system. So, let's start our discussion first with the covalent modification. So, first, we will discuss about covalent modification of enzyme. Now, to understand this, suppose this is the enzyme molecule. Enzyme binds with some small molecule through a covalent bond. So, this is the covalent bond. Remember, only some enzyme is able to bind with some other molecule through the covalent linkage. When this covalent binding occurs, it leads to change in this enzyme's activity. So, that means activity might increase or it might decrease. And that is how this covalent modification of enzyme is able to bring about in the change in the enzyme's activity. Most of the time, this small molecule is a phosphate molecule. And this phosphate molecule covalently binds with the enzyme through the hydroxyl group. This hydroxyl group is present on the enzyme. You might think that from where does this hydroxyl group is coming? See, enzymes are protein, right? And protein is simply a polymer of amino acids. So we have several amino acids which have hydroxyl, or you can say OH group is present. What are these amino acids? These amino acids are serine, tyrosine, and threonine. So with the help of these three amino acids hydroxyl group, this phosphate molecule can bind with the enzyme. Now let's see that how phosphate can be added to the enzyme. So suppose this is the enzyme and currently this enzyme is not bound with any phosphate, right? So we will simply show OH group. So this form of enzyme can be called as a dephosphorylated form. Dephosphorylated form of enzyme. Now to add phosphate into this dephosphorylated form, ATP molecules donates its phosphate. So ATP, after giving its phosphate molecule to this enzyme, ATP gets converted to ADP, that is adenosine diphosphate. And this enzyme, after getting the phosphate molecule, and this phosphate molecule binds with this hydroxyl group. So we have this oxygen atom of hydroxyl group, and this oxygen atom binds with the phosphate molecule. So now this form of enzyme is called as a phosphorylated form. Or simply you can call it as a phosphoprotein. Phosphoprotein. You can also call it as a phosphoenzyme. But as all enzymes are protein, we can simply refer to it as a phosphoprotein. So this process is called as a phosphorylation. And this phosphorylation process is not a spontaneous process, rather it is catalyzed by another enzyme, that is protein kinase. So it is surprising, right, that one enzyme is modifying another enzyme, right, this enzyme. Now this process is also possible backward, but through different route. So that means this phosphorylated form can be converted back to the dephosphorylated form. And during this process, this phosphate is removed in the form of inorganic phosphate. And this process is called as a dephosphorylation. And this dephosphorylation process is also catalyzed by one enzyme, and that is phosphoprotein. Phosphoprotein, that is obviously a name of substrate, followed by phosphatase. Remember, this protein kinase and this phosphoprotein phosphatase, these are not the name of individual enzyme. Rather, protein kinase as well as phosphoprotein phosphatase, both are different group of enzyme. Each type of protein kinase and each type of phosphoprotein phosphatase are specific for each particular enzyme. Here I had written generalized enzyme. Okay, I am not specifying any name of enzyme. So this is the generalized name of the enzyme. Now remember one more thing, that some enzymes are active in their dephosphorylated form, and whereas some enzymes are active in their phosphorylated form. So what are the example? In the case of enzymes which are active in the dephosphorylated form, we have glycogen synthase, Then we have acetyl coenzyme A, that is acetyl coenzyme A carboxylase, and HMG CoA reductase. Similarly, what are the different enzymes which are active when they are phosphorylated? So we have one very good example of a glycogen phosphorylase. This is the most important one. We have several more entries, but we will focus mainly on the glycogen phosphorylase. Now this glycogen phosphorylase is an interesting one. So let's discuss more about this glycogen phosphorylase. See, this glycogen phosphorylase, this is the dephosphorylated form of glycogen phosphorylase. We know that glycogen phosphorylase is active in its phosphorylated form. So how does this glycogen phosphorylase gets converted to glycogen phosphorylase, which is phosphorylated? This is the active form. Now in this reaction is catalyzed by the enzyme. Here the generalized name is the protein kinase, right? So here what is the protein? This glycogen phosphorylase. So first, instead of protein, we'll write glycogen phosphorylase followed by kinase. So this is the name of enzyme which is catalyzing the phosphorylation of glycogen phosphorylase to its phosphorylated form. Now this glycogen phosphorylase kinase itself is active in the form whenever it is phosphorylated. So here the second entry can be glycogen phosphorylase kinase. As you can see, it is active in its phosphorylated form. So now let's see this, that how this glycogen phosphorylase kinase itself is getting phosphorylated. So obviously, initially we have a glycogen phosphorylase kinase which is not in its phosphorylated form. That means this is the dephosphorylated form. It needs to get converted into its phosphorylated form. So this catalysis is carried out by another enzyme, that is cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. Okay, see, the generalized name which carries out phosphorylation is the protein kinase, right? But in this case, what will happen? It is a protein kinase, but it is dependent on the cyclic AMP. Okay, so it is the specific one for this catalysis. Now this cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase, so name itself is suggesting that its activity is modulated by the cyclic AMP. And this cyclic AMP is, its concentration inside the cell is maintained by various hormones. For example, glucagon, epinephrine, these hormones maintain the level of cyclic AMP. So in turn, cyclic AMP decides the activity of protein kinase, which in turn decides the activity of glycogen phosphorylase kinase, which in turn decides the activity of glycogen phosphorylase. So see how these hormones are able to change in any chemical reaction. So that is how regulation occurs. Now let's discuss the next activity, that is proteolytic activation. So the next topic is the proteolytic activation. Now what happens in the proteolytic activation? Suppose this round represents amino acids and this horizontal line represents peptide bond. Suppose this is the protein, right? And we know that enzymes are protein. So let's say this protein is the enzyme. Now this enzyme currently is in its inactive form. Now what happens? Some another enzyme comes and let's say it breaks down this peptide bond. So what will happen? This fragment is released, right? So we have this 4 amino acid long fragment and this portion is separated, right? So let's say this, it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. This fragment of the enzyme is now active, right? So as you can see, here not entire molecule of this enzyme is undergoing proteolysis, okay? It is only a small portion. So this proteolytic activation is sometimes called as a limited proteolysis, okay? And this, after proteolysis, this enzyme becomes active. So this inactive form of enzyme is many a time referred as a proenzyme, or it can also called as a zymogen. Basically, this larger molecule of enzyme is an inactive precursor enzyme. Okay, and finally, active enzyme, that is after proteolysis, it is called as an active enzyme. One thing to note down over here is that this proteolysis process is a rapid one, but it is irreversible. Okay, and this proteolysis always leads to enzyme activation. It is unlike this covalent modification. In the covalent modification, we had seen that enzyme's activity might increase or decrease, but it is not so in case of proteolytic activation. In the proteolytic activation, it is always enzyme activation. Okay, so what are the examples of enzyme which can undergo proteolytic activation? So we have several enzymes of protein digestion. These are pepsinogen, then trypsinogen, then chymotrypsinogen, then proelastase, and we have procarboxypeptidase. So these enzymes are undergoing proteolytic activation. Generally, this proenzyme or zymogens, either they had given this gen at the end of word, or there is a word pro at the starting of the word. See, this pepsinogen undergo proteolysis and gets converted to active form, that is pepsin. This proteolysis is initially carried out by the hydrochloric acid, and later on it is carried out by the pepsin. Okay, so see, the product itself is catalyzing its own activation, so it is called as a autoactivation. Remember, autoactivation does not always occur in case of proteolytic activation. In case of trypsinogen, trypsinogen gets converted to the active trypsin, and here this activation is carried out by the enteropeptidase. And later on, it will be carried out by the trypsin itself also. So here also, this is an example of autoactivation. In case of chymotrypsinogen, it gets converted into its active form, that is chymotrypsin. And in this case, this activation is catalyzed by the enzyme trypsin. So remember, this is not the example of autocatalysis. This proelastase is activated to the elastase, and this is also catalyzed by this same enzyme, that is trypsin. Here, procarboxypeptidase is activated to carboxypeptidase, and this is also catalyzed by the enzyme trypsin. So this last three, this chymotrypsin, elastase and carboxypeptidase, these are not the example of autoactivation. Whereas this pepsin and trypsin, they are the example of autoactivation. And remember, in all of this activation process, one small polypeptide fragment is released. Okay, there is one more example of this proteolytic activation in case of blood coagulation. See, in the blood coagulation, initially what happens? Factor 12, it undergoes proteolysis, limited proteolysis, and gets converted into its active form. Now here the active form is represented by this subscript A. So now this factor 12A is activated. This factor 12A, it activates factor 11. And so factor 11 undergo limited proteolysis and gives its active form, right? This factor 11A, it catalyzes the activation of factor 9. So factor 9 by the proteolytic activation gets converted to factor 9, which is in the activated form. And this factor 9 further activates factor 10. So factor 10 to activated factor 10A. So these all steps are the examples of proteolytic activation. Now the next topic that we need to discuss is the cascade mechanism. So the next one, the cascade mechanism. Remember, the cascade means a stepwise. So in the cascade mechanism, what happens? There is a stepwise activation of series of enzyme, series of enzymes. Now see, in this, suppose there is one enzyme E1, it activates next enzyme, that is E2. This E2 activates next enzyme, that is E3. So on and so forth occur. So such stepwise activation of this series of enzyme is called as a cascade mechanism. Now what are the examples of this cascade mechanism? We had already seen two examples of cascade mechanism. See, the first example is of this blood coagulation. Here, as you can see, this factor 12 is activating 11, 11 is activating factor 9, and factor 9 is activating factor 10A, right? So the first example is the blood coagulation factors. The second example that we had seen in this covalent modification. So here, as you can see, this cyclic AMP-dependent protein kinase is activating glycogen phosphorylase kinase. And this glycogen phosphorylase kinase is activating glycogen phosphorylase. So here we can see three steps, right? So this glycogen phosphorylase is the second example. Glycogen phosphorylase activation. Okay, so these two are the examples of cascade mechanism. Now you might be wondering that what is the advantage of this cascade mechanism? The main advantage of cascade mechanism is the amplification of response. Now let's try to understand this amplification of response with the help of blood coagulation. See, for this example's purpose, let's say we have only one factor 12 activated. We have only one molecule. And let's say at each step, 10x response occurs. Okay? That means that within 1 minute, this enzyme, it further catalyzes the activation of 10 more enzymes, right? So initially, we have only one molecule of activated factor 12. Now, in this case, and we know that enzymes are never consumed in the reaction, right? So, this factor 12A will be continuously working on the factor 11 to make it active, right? So, one molecule in 1 minute, it will activate 10 molecules of factor 11. Now, further, this 10 molecule on the 10x magnitude, it activates 10 into 10, that is 100 molecules of factor 9A. And here, this factor 9A, it activates factor 10A, and so now ultimately we have 1000 molecules of activated factor 10. So as you can see, in this hypothetical example, only one molecule, it leads to amplification of response to the 1000 times, right? So that is the main advantage of amplification of response in case of cascade mechanism. Similarly, what is the advantage of this proteolytic activation? See what happens. All these protein digestive enzymes, all these protein digestion enzymes, they need to remain inactive inside our body. Why? Because if they are active inside our body, what will happen? It will digest our own protein and it is dangerous for our body, right? So what will happen? Whenever these enzymes are secreted into our intestinal cavity, then only they get activated. So their action will be at the desired place. Right? In case of blood coagulation, what will happen if this all factors are active? Then our blood will clot instantly. But this is not required. This is required whenever body injury occurs. At that time only blood needs to coagulate at only that localized site, right? So by this proteolytic activation, by this enzymes remain in its inactive form in our body, that is important. And whenever body injury occurs, at that time only its activation is required. So that is how our body controls it. In case of this covalent modification, what happens? Our metabolic needs are different at a different time. Okay. So we have various hormones, and these hormones by this covalent modification, they control various enzymes, and that's how metabolism can be controlled. Okay, so with this, I complete a discussion of covalent modification, proteolytic activation, and cascade mechanism. In the next video tutorial, we'll discuss further about this remaining methods of enzyme regulation. If you have any query or confusion, please write it down in the comment section below. Thank you.